Good afternoon, Understanding Principles for Better Living Church. Happy Resurrection Day. Yes. Here to celebrate the resurrected Christ. And you know that he is good, amen? So stand to your feet, those who can, as we declare that he is good. Yes.
Christ consciousness within me. Today I rise to the Christ consciousness within me. I remember Romans 8:11. The spirit of him who raised Jesus from the dead dwells in you. As I reflect on this day of resurrection, I know that there are no limits in my life, including my physical body and environment. This whole day is about limitless living. Limitless living. We will be dropping limits today. I release crucifixion-like limiting beliefs and focus on the expansive activity of the Spirit of eternal life. I am grateful for another opportunity to remember and celebrate resurrection experiences that have afforded me new levels of awareness and consciousness. I rise in consciousness to infinite. Somebody say infinite. Infinite spiritual possibilities in my life. I know that with Spirit, nothing is impossible to me. I do not spend any energy complaining, wondering, questioning, or crying. I turn my attention to Spirit, which has already removed all things that could nail me down. I let go of my limitations and I rise. And the scripture is Luke 24, 34, the Lord has risen. God bless you.
And what I can do. And if you only, if you know the truth, all that I am lives inside of you. I can do exceedingly, abundantly, above all that you ever asked.
That you ask.
Think of me, whatever you need,
whatever
I can be. Therefore I say,
when you pray,
believe, and you shall receive. No limit to
what I can do,
what I
can
do,
through to you.
I gotta get you to see. Read it in Mark 11, 23.
Say it
without doubt and have faith in me. I know that you have hope. And you have dreams, oh yes you do. And I hope that you know by now that you can have everything. You can have everything that you ever and everything you need, if you take the limits off of me. 'Cause I can do
exceedingly,
abundantly, above all that you ask, whatever you need.
Therefore I say,
when you pray, you shall receive.
There is no
limit to
what I can
try to
get
through
to you.
To you. You to
I gotta
see.
Get
you
to
see.
Read it in.
Read it in. Mark 11, 23.
Without doubt.
Because there's nothing
impossible.
There's nothing impossible to me.
To me.
Come on. many, and traditionally you may have come and celebrated Easter, the resurrection, in a different way. And I want us to all get together so that we can have a common understanding of the crucifixion that we're working with here at Up Church. We've come together to pray in remembrance of him who on this day, nearly 2,000 years ago, met and finally overcame every obstacle that life on the mortal plane can present to humankind. This was the supreme test of life here on earth. The time when he proved that humankind, having faith in God, can rise above all earthly limitations to attain spiritual perfection. That's the lesson of Jesus the Christ. We at Understanding Principles for Better Living Church do not think of Easter in sorrowful terms, nor do we attempt to enter into the suffering of Jesus by emphasizing the horrors of crucifixion, which was one of the most cruel ways of putting people to death. We see this as a beautiful and profoundly sacred occasion. We see in it an experience through which the soul passes from sense to spiritual, from material to spiritual. It represents the crossing out of all that belongs to humankind's unregenerate nature. That's all of the base things you see in society, all of the things that we do to hurt one another. We're crossing that out. Our false beliefs, our destructive emotions. Jesus took his place among people, revealing to them the light which lights every person coming into the world. But they that did not comprehend his words did not know that he came with that light. And on the cross, he showed those who follow after him how to erase the negative states of mind that hold men and women back and down, and how to speak the word that releases us from bondage. Jesus Christ is our way shower. His words from the cross represent steps to be taken in the redemption of the human consciousness. Throughout his life on earth, he taught these steps, and his words from the cross reveal and sum up the states of consciousness to be attained in the liberation of our own soul. 7 times he spoke words that reveal his final emancipation from human bondage. 4 times love, the resurrecting power, spoke through Jesus, first as forgiveness of enemies, then as impersonal love, extending mercy and compassion to a stranger. Love in its personal aspect, protecting and tender, was expressed in his thought for his mother. And finally, his love of God burst forth in absolute truth and complete surrender. Today is our opportunity to enter into this freeing process that begins with forgiveness and ends with the surrender of the soul to our Father, Mother, God. Let's go within. And we just open ourselves up for the revelation in our soul that we have heard the true meaning of the crucifixion. That through the Christ in me, I can and do cross out all that does not belong to me as a child of God. Through the Christ in me, I can and do cross out all that does not belong to me as a child of God. Thank you, God. I release and let go. I release and let go. And so it is. Amen.
I've got so much to thank God for. So many wonderful blessings and so many open
you.
I used to think that I should. I used to think that scripture told me I had to be good. Now I love because I want to. I love because I'm free. Blinded by the Spirit. The Spirit of God is upon me.
Oh, oh, oh.
Oh, the Spirit,
Spirit of God is upon me.
Is upon me.
Oh, oh, oh.
Yeah. Blinded by spirit, oh Lord, yeah. Spirit of God is upon me.
Oh,
spirit,
Spirit of God is upon me.
Spirit of God is upon me.
Spirit of God is upon me.
Spirit of God. Loving God would be hard, but loving God is wonderful. Oh, it's ecstasy. Thank God for my freedom. Oh, the Spirit of God is upon me.
Oh,
Spirit of God,
Spirit of God is upon me.
Is upon me.
Spirit of God is upon me.
Spirit of God is upon me.
Spirit of God is upon me.
I walk the path.
Spirit of God is upon me.
I thank the Lord every morning, every day,
every
night, every night, every day. Spirit of God.
Spirit of God is upon me.
Spirit.
This morning, I woke up with the word recourse on my heart. That just, like, it was like, there are times when God talks to me and it is, like, it's like, it's louder than anything else going on. And I wake up and it's the only thing that I can think about, and it's almost like it's being shouted in my ears. And so I kept hearing, I have recourse, I have recourse. I said, well, I guess that's the Easter message. Let me start rearranging what I thought I was going to say. Recourse is a source of help in a difficult situation. It also means the use of someone or something as a source of help in a difficult situation. It's the legal right to demand payment or compensation. And so this thought, I have recourse, kept
playing over and over in my heart and mind. And so finally I said, okay, yes, God, the good news that I came to bring you is that I have recourse. Somebody say recourse. With most retailers, especially ones with a big name, I have recourse if I get a product and it's faulty in some way. I bought a replacement dome for my New Wave oven in November, and by the time January rolled around, it had cracked worse than the one that I had purchased to replace it. So now I've spent $60 on this replacement dome, but because I ordered from Amazon.com, I was able to return the cracked dome and receive a full refund, right? I was able to ship FedEx at no charge to me in order to return the defective dome. And I could do that because I have recourse. But something was happening along the way. They had given me a deadline for redeeming this offer to return the defective dome. And as I was thinking about, I have recourse, God said to me that there's a difference between man's recourse and my recourse. See, with the cracked oven dome, I had a time frame within which I had to return it, or my refund would have been void. And I would have been stuck not only with the broken dome, but also with the $60 it cost to buy the dome that broke. And what I learned is that God doesn't work that way. There's no expiration date on God's recourse. I can always get a refund, a redo, and a do-over, or whatever else I need. If I ever find myself walking down a road that isn't working for me, no matter how long I've been walking down that road, I've got some recourse. I can call up the manufacturer, have a conversation about what's not working with this road that I'm on, get a new direction that works. So I've got recourse. And my message for you today is that the cross is your recourse. Because whatever I'm facing, no matter how big it seems, I can nail it to the cross because I've got recourse. It doesn't matter what it looks like because I've got recourse. It doesn't matter how long I've been dealing with it because I've got recourse. It doesn't matter if you think I can make it through. It doesn't matter if I think I can make it through. I still have. Okay. The cross is proof that I have recourse. I can take whatever I'm dealing with, nail it to the cross, and begin again. The cross means that I have a do-over. It means I'm never stuck. Even if I'm delayed, it's okay because I have recourse. Now, I'm going to ask you to do that a little later. You have a card in your bulletin, yes? Okay, you have a card in your bulletin on which you can write down whatever you are nailing to the cross. And so we're going to leave some things on the cross before we leave here today. On February 14th, we began a journey together. We started a daily morning call to talk about the process of working daily with God. We used a book called The Path to Wealth. We named God in our experience so as to personalize the relationship with the power that indwells us. We set an intention for the path. 15 days into the journey, we began working with our 30-day journals, meeting with God every day to work out our own salvation. To say this process was fun would be an understatement. In fact, let me hear you praise God for what it's felt like to work with God over these last 40 days.
Yes! It has been awesome. The path, as we name this journey, is a process. It is a process for working with your I am, your indwelling Christ. Within you lies this formless good. It has no texture, no color, no taste, no sound, no form. You need a way to get the good out of you into expression. How do you do that? You need a system. So we gave you a system. What are the steps? What's step one? Read something inspirational. You might need to redo the whole. Read something inspirational. Step number two? Write a letter to God. Step number three? Read the letter out loud. Step number four? Imagine one of your goals. Put yourself in the place of your dream realized. Number five? Notice God. There you go, girl. Notice God all day. Number six? Celebrate the wins. Thank God for the wins. Celebrate. Get you an accountability partner spiritually and celebrate your wins. Number seven? Forgiveness and gratitude. The path has been about supplying you with a system for daily communing with God in you. Through that daily communion, miracles result. It is fair to say that a life without miracles is proof of a life without daily communion with God. See, the moment that you throw the door open to God through daily communion, miracles become your norm. The moment you get on the path, life improves. The path is a process. A process for what? It's a process by which you get your future, which lies within you, out into expression. Go to Genesis chapter 1, verse 12. Genesis chapter 1, verse 12. You can pull it up on your phone or your tablet. Genesis chapter 1, verse 12. Somebody say amen when you have it. When you have it, Angela. Genesis chapter 1, verse 12. I want to show you something that you have seen but probably never saw. And the earth brought forth grass and herb yielding seed after his kind, and the tree yielding fruit whose seed was in itself after his kind, and God saw that it was good. I want you to underline or mark in some way the words whose seed was in itself. Whose seed was in itself. That's what I want you to pay attention to. Everything that God made contains the seed of itself within itself. And God never changes. How God does anything is how God does everything. God is real consistent. You can depend on God. Apple seeds planted give you apple trees, which give you you've had one before. Orange seeds planted give you an orange grove, which gives you everything God made contains the seed of itself within itself. The forest is not ahead of the seed, it's in the seed. Your future is not ahead of you, it's in you. Every day you walk around with your future inside of you. Depending on whether you show up for God in you every day depends on whether or not you bless or curse your future. One of the keys to understanding the universe is to realize that God placed the future of the thing
in the thing itself. It's the way he designed it. You came to the planet fully loaded. God designed you that way. You need to tell somebody, I'm fully loaded. Don't judge me by what you see. I'm fully loaded. Oh, you need to say it like you believe it. I'm fully loaded. See, when you know who you are and that you carry your future in you, you lose your taste for petty squabbles and ongoing conflicts. I can't fight you. I've got my future inside of me. And if I waste my energy on you, I don't have time for getting the good out of me into expression. I can't afford not to forgive you. Maze from Frankie Beverly got this song. I know you know it. Too many games that people play. Y'all don't know that song? I gotta get to the chorus. Yep. Man, look that up. Too many games that people play. I only have time for games when I don't know who I am and what I'm carrying. That's the only time I play games. I'm gonna step on some toes. When you know what you carry and you stop hitting the snooze button. When you know what you carry and you stop hitting the snooze button. When you know what you're carrying, you're not tired at the end of your day of work. Over the past 40 days of Lent, we've been teaching you how to connect with the seed inside of you and get it out into expression. We gave you some specific steps, but the steps don't matter as much as the daily contact. I said the steps don't matter as much as the daily contact. See, now that you have a system, now you want to make it your own. Just keep a system. So you might modify it by adding some music. Maybe you might extend the reading portion of it. Maybe you might shorten the imagination part of it. But you've got the elements, right? You got the system. Now make it yours and stick with it. This is how you get the forest out of the seed. This is how you get the oak out of the acorn. The path is how you get the spiritual giant out of you into expression. Ecclesiastes chapter 3, verse 11. Ecclesiastes chapter 3, verse 11. I want to show you another principle of how God works. Ecclesiastes chapter 3, verse 11. Also, he put eternity in their hearts. Except that no one can find out the work that God does from beginning to end. Eternity in this verse refers to the presence I am that indwells you. He has put I am in your heart. In the ancient Hebrew, heart refers to what we in the modern world would call the subconscious mind. He has put I am in the subconscious mind. Except that no one can find out the work that God does from beginning to end. The way this reads, it seems like there's something that God is purposely keeping you in the dark about, but he's put the capacity for you to look back into the past and the ability to peek into the future, but yet he's not given you the ability to see the whole picture. And that's a misreading of the verse. What this verse is telling us is that God has set up this world in such a way that you must see things his way if you are going to understand what's going on. Here, let me help you. God never gave Adam any tables, chairs, or beds. He hid them in the trees. You're going to need to get the tape. God never gave Adam a house. He hid it in the rock and the mud and the processes by which the rock and the mud are converted to materials for making a house. God never gave Adam any specific food, but he hid the foods in the combinations of the various elements. the path changes you and how you do things. You consciously participate in your own salvation by seeing the same thing you've been looking at differently. See, nothing changes until you can see your circumstances differently. So while you're sitting in the mess, if you could try to see the mess differently, then you could get a different result. And so as I was preparing for this, I thought, well, how long did Adam have to lay on that hard ground before he started looking at them trees differently? How long did Adam have to stand before he saw a chair in the tree? How long will you look at the inconveniences in your life before you see them differently? See, the path changes you and how you do things. On the path, you look at the same things you've been looking at, but new elements reveal themselves to you that you never saw before. On the path, somebody will hand you 2 fish and 5 loaves and say, this is all we got. And you say, that's all right, darling. I'm working with the I am inside of me. This is more than enough to do what God wants to do through me. See, on the path, they might tell you that your dream is dead. And you say, don't worry, darling. I got recourse. Lazarus, come forth. And the dream must get up. Yes. On the path, you realize that nothing is as it seems to be. It is as I see it. And as I see it better, it gets better. You recognize, like Paul, that in the presence of I am who I believe, God in me gives life to the dead and calls those things which do not exist as though they did. Nothing is as it seems to be. It is as I see it. And so this is why Jesus could say to the woman in John 11, 25 and 26, I am the resurrection and the life. Those who believe in me, even though they die, will live. And everyone who lives and believes in me will never die. I am is your unconditioned awareness of being. It's the you that has not yet become. And yet, no matter what you become, there always remains a part of you that can become more than you have ever been. Your recourse depends on you claiming, I am the resurrection and the life. Through I am, I can awaken long dead dreams. Through I am, I can pull the chair out of the tree. Through I am, I can pull the house out of the mud and rock. Through I can break the earth's atmosphere and travel the galaxies. Through I can cure the seemingly incurable diseases. I can do all things through I am who strengthens me. So I'm not beset by seeming intractable problems that I see in the world, because I know that a consciousness unified with I am can pull a chair out of a tree. One unified with the power and presence of God within can solve whatever seems the problem that won't go away. There are no problems. There are no problems. Only opportunities for me to connect with I am and work a miracle where it looks like things might not have worked out. I have recourse. So I'm not moved by a petty mess. I'm not moved by your racist taunts and your threats. I'm not moved by unjust man-made laws. I'm not even moved by what it seems like I can't do. I am the resurrection and the life. I don't believe in job loss. I believe in I am. I don't believe in cancer. I believe in I am. I don't believe in diabetes. I believe in I am. Why? Because Jesus said, those who believe in I am, even though they die, will live. And everyone who lives and believes in I am will never die. God has a present solution for every problem, but I can't get the chair out the tree unless and until I unify with I am. And do the daily work of getting the chair out of the tree. And so every morning that I sit down at my desk, this chair is coming out this tree today. Every morning. My whole life changed when I realized that God was waiting on me. Can you believe that? I thought I was waiting on God. Isn't that what the songs tell us? Teach us, Lord. Teach us, Lord, how to wait. They that wait. It blew my entire mind to learn that God was waiting on me. The path begins when I show up for God in me. The chair begins its journey out of the tree when I show up for God in me. How many chairs, Lord, are waiting for me to show up? Nothing new is coming. Everything you will ever get in life will be a recombination of what already exists. Did you know the periodic chart? You know what the periodic chart is, right? Okay, all right. The periodic chart is fixed. No new elements are coming. What will be created will be a refashioning of what already exists. Creation is finished. Your job is to show up daily for God and learn how to get the chair out of the tree. Morehouse professor, Dr. Hadia Nicole Green. Some of you have heard her name before. Dr. Hadia Nicole Green. She is currently using nanoparticles to permanently shrink cancer cells. Having nursed the great aunt and uncle who raised her through cancer, she felt there had to be a better way. So she put herself through school, earning a PhD in physics. Two questions drove her research. If we can see from outer space that a dime on the ground is face up or face down, why can't we have greater accuracy in the treatment of cancer? And if we can ring a cell phone in a room full of cell phones, but only ring one phone, why can't we employ that level of technology in the way that we approach cancer? And so she figured that since no one had thought of it before, maybe this was hers to figure out. The chair that you pull out of the tree will be a chair that no one else has ever imagined before. You go to the tree motivated by self-interest. You go to the tree motivated by self-interest, but what you pull out blesses all of humanity. This is probably going to rattle you. Jesus was motivated by the need to help his people who were under the thumb of the Roman Empire and the greedy upper class Jews who'd keep them down just to have a few crumbs from the Romans. Do not be afraid of self-interest. Self-interest will drive you to the tree, but what you pull out will become of service to all of humankind. Your daily inreach activates your partnership with God. Every day that you show up strengthens the connection between you and God. The Apostle Paul, or more likely a student of the Apostle Paul writing under his name, reminds us in 2 Timothy chapter 1, verses 6 and 7, therefore I remind you to stir up the gift of God which is in you. The gift of God is I am. It's your job to stir it up. And then he goes on to say, because he gives you a descriptor of I am, for God has not given us a spirit of fear, but of power and of love and of a sound mind. The gift is I am. The qualities of I am is that it's strong, it's powerful, and it's stable. You are both the inlet
and the outlet for all there is in God. And in an ideal setting, God flows right through you instantaneously into expression. No delay. Taxes due, the first fish that opens his mouth got your money. Body won't stop hemorrhaging. Make immediate contact. Hemorrhaging stopped. But many times there seems to be a delay. I'm trying to get the chair out of the tree, and I only have a leg. And I seem to be stuck. But I'm never stuck. Because I am, I always have recourse. And that recourse lies in my expressed gratitude and my willingness to forgive. You gain momentum on the path when you express gratitude and forgive everything and everyone. The rest of the chair will come out of the tree when you give gratitude and forgive. This is for everybody born before the year 1990. Touch your neighbor, say, were you born before 1990? Okay. All right. So this one is for you. You have unlimited energy. Unlimited energy. God designed you that way. But he did not design you to have divided energy. You cannot get the chair out of the tree and hold on to anger, hate, and resentment. You're going to have to choose. Do I want the chair or do I want the anger? Do I want the chair or do I want the resentment? Because I cannot have both. The writer of James warns us that a double-minded man is unstable in all his ways. The stable mind, focused in one direction, gets the chair out of the tree. The stable mind, focused in one direction, solves the problems of the world that seem to be intractable. Dr. Green could not sit in the sorrow of losing the aunt and uncle who raised her and cure cancer. She had to choose. I can have the sorrow or I can have the cure, but I can't have both. Jesus could not sit in the anger and the resentment for the discrimination of his people and go through the cross. It's popular to say that it wasn't the nails that held him to the cross, but I came to tell you that it was love that got him off. See, for Jesus, the chair that needed to come out of the tree was the proof that you can overcome death. But he could not do it holding on to all the stuff that was done to him and his people. Let me help you, because we have built this namby-pamby Jesus, kumbaya. He's the most sanitized dude you ever want to meet. And if you really read him, I mean really read him, he is a radical revolutionary who is upsetting the apple cart in his time. You don't crucify somebody as the enemy of the state if they hugging and kissing on babies. Talking about suffer the little children. We have sanitized him. This man was a radical. But he had to learn to get out of his feelings and get into I am. Sometimes we feel like we can't get out of our feelings, but that's like saying, I don't want to exercise because I sweat. I mean, that's what it, the process of getting into I am means getting out of your feelings. What do you want? Do you want to be effective or do you just want to be a bag of wind? He couldn't do it holding on to all the stuff. And so you see him saying, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do.
He couldn't go through the cross and wish that it could have happened another way. And so you see him say, not my will, but thy will be done. He couldn't do it holding on to human attachments. So he says, John, here is your mother. Mother, here is your new son. God has a chair that he needs you to pull out of the tree, but it cannot be done holding on to all that you're holding on to right now. You're going to have to let some stuff go. And so in your bulletin, you have a card. My guess is that you already know what you need to let go of. You already know why that chair won't come out of the tree. And so on that card, I want you to write down what you're nailing to the cross. Nariko, could you come follow me? Write down what's not leaving this sanctuary with you today. When you get in your car, you're going to be just a little bit lighter, a few pounds lighter, because something is not leaving this room with you. Maybe you're afraid to take action because you think people will laugh at your efforts. Maybe you think you're too old for the chair you want to pull out the tree. Maybe you think you're not smart enough to get the tree that God told you you're supposed to pull out, the chair that God told you you're supposed to pull out. Maybe you're retired and you don't feel like it. And you start thinking about all that work it's going to take to get that chair out of that tree. You're like, nah, the next generation going to have to get this one. You write that down on that card. Maybe you believe there's not enough money to do what God is calling you to do. That's what you write on the card. Maybe you have suffered so many setbacks that you're afraid to get specific, because you don't want to be disappointed again. Maybe your whole life has been such a struggle that it's hard to imagine life that's not a struggle. Write that down. Write down whatever you are leaving on the cross. These are the things that we need to give. See, God told me that there are going to be some breakthroughs today, but you can only break through if you choose to let it go. I cannot choose for you. I cannot do your growing for you. We want to help our children. There are things I want to protect Jordan from. I do my best, but I cannot do his living for him.
That forgives, a heart full of love, one with compassion just like yours above, one that overcomes evil with goodness and love. Like it never happened, never holding a grudge. Want a heart that forgives, that lives and lets live, one that keeps loving over and over again. One that men can offend because your word is within. One that loves without price like you, Lord Jesus Christ. Want a heart that loves everybody, even my enemies. Want a love like you, be like you, just like you did. I want a heart that forgives. I want a heart that forgives when the ones that are closest that I've known most. I still want to love them just like you love me, even though I'm hurting. I want a heart that forgives when the pain is so deep. It's so hard to speak about it to anyone, just like your son. I give up my right to hold it against them with hatred inside. I want a heart that loves everybody, even my enemies. I want to love like and be like and just like and did. I want to walk like and talk like, just like you did. Wanna be like you, live like you, just like you did. Cause a heart that forgives is the heart that will live totally free from the pain of the past. And the heart that lets go is the heart that will know so much freedom. Lord, I want to let it go.
Hey, hallelujah.
God, I need to let it go. Lord, it's been holding me back. And I don't want it, I don't want it, I don't want it no more. I don't know exactly what to do to get rid of it, but here I am, Lord Jesus. Here I am, oh, here I am, Lord Jesus. Oh, Lord, I need you, I need you. I know this is me that you're talking to. This is me, this is me, this is me, Lord, this is me. Lord, I let it go. Every person that's ever hurt me, God, I let it go. Every single hurt, God, I let it go. Every single pain, God, I let it go. I let it go. I let it go. Lord, you can have. Lord, you can have it. Lord, you can have it. Lord, you can have it. You can have it now. You can have it now. 'Cause I don't want it now.